You know, I'd say to him, Grandad, when are we going to Main Road? He said to me, well, the only time you bloody go to Main Road if it's on fire or if United are playing there. This club is unique. There is not another club in this world that can compare to the Manchester United Football Club.
Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for a man who is renowned all over the world. He's loved, he's adored. He has his own dinner that he's been running for the best part of 17 years. I'm delighted and honored to say I'm involved with that dinner. He is a legend. He's a historian. He's an author. He's over from the USA at the moment with his beautiful wife, Cheryl. Please put your hands together for Charlton on Medlock's very own Mr. Thomas Clare, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you.
Thank you, Alan, for that wonderful introduction. It's an absolute privilege and a pleasure to be here amongst the United family. There's nothing better than the Red family. You know, when one bleeds, we all bleed. And it's absolutely magic to be in your company. And to listen to Roy and his tales, it takes me back to my younger days, very, very similar to Roy. I was born in that wonderful suburb of Manchester, just south of Piccadilly, called Chalton-on-Medlock, where if you paid the rent 1 week, then the police were around to find where you got the money from. And as a youngster, you know, very little money about in those days, just after the Second World War. And my mother used to go down to the Army and Navy stores most times to pick up odd bits of clothing, you know, just to try and keep us properly clothed. But it was no fun going to school looking like a bloody Japanese admiral, you know. So they were hard days, but they were absolutely wonderful. And the outlet for all of us kids back then was football and Manchester United. I was tutored in the United way by my grandfather, who followed United from 1898. And he drummed it into me about the history of the club. As I grew up, he taught me, you know, where the foundation of the club was, what the main characters was, how we nearly went bust in 1902, and the change from Newton Heath to Manchester United, and then the first glory years from 1907 through to 1912. Now, we didn't win a trophy then until 1948. Could you imagine what would have happened then? You know, with social media the way it is today, we went all them years without winning a major trophy. And also, in 1931, we almost went bust again. But we were saved by a wonderful man, a gentleman called James W Gibson. Now, little did we know then the impact that James W Gibson was going to have on Manchester United and its future. Because contrary to what a lot of people believe, Sir Matt Busby did not find the youth system. That idea was James W. Gibson's. In 1937, he came up with a plan. Too much money had been wasted on transfer fees of players who weren't up for it. And he sat down and he told the board, he said, look, what we need to do is to go out and find the best young footballers, local footballers around, bring them into the club, and we'll form a system where we bring them through from junior football that will service then the first, eventually service the first team. But unfortunately, just as the system got going, they put the Mujacks team together, the Manchester United Junior Athletic Club, and they played in the Chalton Amateur League. And in the first season, 1938-39, in, I think it was 26 games, they scored an incredible 260 goals. you know. So it had started to produce its roots, but then came the Second World War, and of course 6 years was lost. And Louis Rocker then wrote to Matt Busby and asked him, you know, he said, Matt, if you want to come and join us, you know, there's a job here for you. So in 1945, late 1945, Busby sat down at the Cornbrook Cold Storage, where the club's offices were at the time, and he sat in an interview with James W. Gibson, and they both bounced their ideas off each other. And Sir Matt Busby embraced the youth policy fully. And we had returning players, players that had started to come through before the war. When they came back, he had the nucleus of a really, really good team. And as they progressed, they won the FA Cup in 1948. The reserve team was doing well, but Jimmy Murphy went to see him. He brought Jimmy in as his assistant, which was, you know, a fantastic thing to do. And Jimmy looked after the reserve team. And Jimmy went to him after the year that they'd won the Cup, and he told Matt, he said, look, he said, although we may have done well in the Central League, he said, there's not one player there that I can, you know, really say is first team material. So Matt said, well, we've got to go out, we've got to find our own young players. And Louis Rocker was the chief scout, but he had a little fella there with him called Joe Armstrong. And Joe had got so many contacts. He was an ex-GPO engineer. He had a lot of contacts with the local schools. And gradually, they started to bring in not only the best players, the best youth players, young players from around Manchester, but also Joe started to network around the country. And we started then to get the best young players in England and Ireland and Scotland and Wales. And it was a tremendous time back then. Although things were tight with families, what used to happen, Manchester Education Committee used to have a system there that United and City used to send them banks of tickets for the Central League games. And they used to distribute them to the schools, 1 week for Old Trafford, 1 week for Main Road. And they'd send the tickets to the school, and they'd also send a bag of what they call bus tokens so that kids could get to the games. And gradually, you know, the youngsters built up the support. And contrary to whatever people believe, there was far more Manchester United supporters in the 50s than there ever was that went near Main Road, you know. And as my grandfather said, you know, I'd say to him, Grandad, when are we going to Main Road? He said to me, well, the only time you bloody go to Main Road if it's on fire or if United are playing there, you know. So it was great. And we started to go to the reserve team games. And my first reserve team game was in 1950 against Sheffield United. And I can remember it as though it's yesterday. I went with my brother, and he still maintains that that's the worst day's work he ever did, was taking me to Old Trafford, you know, because then I became addicted. But the whole club became alive with all these young players. They were coming in one by one, and the whole atmosphere in the club changed. It was full and vibrant of youth. And in 1952-53, the FA introduced the FA Youth Cup. And United were one of the entrants there. And the first FA Youth Cup that was played, it was played at the Cliff, and they played Leeds United, and United won 5-0. And at centre-half for Leeds United was Jack Charlton. You know, so the club then went on. The next game, they beat the team from Northwich 26-0, which is a record. And then you had players gradually moving. After United won the 51-52 championship, they started to move through to the first team. And it was a little bit iffy. It took its time. In 1953, Busby paid $29,999 for who I arguably say is the best centre forward that I've ever seen in my life, and that was big Tommy Taylor. And believe me, that lad he wouldn't have been out of place on a Hollywood film set, I'll tell you. If he was around today, he would be an absolute superstar. But the club then started to become, you know, really successful. We had, as Roy said, we had all these young players all coming in. Three great players for England, Taylor, Byrne, Edwards. They were the nucleus of the England team. And, you know, it was a joy to see them because their outlook was that they'd go out, if a team scored one, we'd scored two. They were involved with some great games against Chelsea, against Aston Villa, where they absolutely demoralised these teams. But they became known as the Busby Babes, which Busby didn't actually like the name. He liked the Red Devils. But again, I'd just like to talk about one or two of them. And of course, Big Duncan is one of them. And I used to follow him all over the place. There was no, with these guys, there was no big-headedness, no pretentiousness, no bigging it up. They were just lovely young boys who used to live and lodge in council houses. And they just loved to play for Manchester United. And, you know, a little story about Big Duncan. I think some of you may have heard it before, but Duncan was so full of his own self-confidence. Nothing fazed him, even at 16, 17. To me, he was the best all-round player that I've ever seen. And I stress, all-round player. He could play in any position. You know, you could play him in the back four, in midfield, or up front. But there was one particular game where they were playing down at Stamford Bridge, and playing for Chelsea was a left-back called Stan Willemsey. And he got stuck into Duncan a few times, but it didn't faze Duncan at all. And midway through the game, Willemsey crept up behind Duncan and he whispered in his ear, he said, "How the bloody hell did you ever get picked for England?" And Duncan just looked at him. He said, "Very easy." He said, "Playing against silly bastards like you every week." You know. And that was it. I mean, Jackie Milburn, he told Jackie Milburn, the great England centre forward, Mr. Milburn, I know, you know, you're such a great player, but, you know, you're not going to get a kick of the ball today. And Jackie said afterwards, he said, "I didn't." But then we had the inside trio of Whelan, Taylor and Violet. And I call them the original Trinity, because if you look at their record, it's second to none. They only actually played 58 games as a trio together. And their goal scoring record is phenomenal. It's almost three goals a game. And Liam Whelan, as Roy said, absolutely magnificent inside forward, full of ball skills. Tommy Taylor, absolutely phenomenal. I'll never forget the greatest game I ever saw Big Tom play was the game against Bilbao in 1957 when we were 5-3 down from the first leg, played at Main Road, pulled two back, and then 10 minutes from the end, Big Tom, he was the first of the big centre-forwards who didn't plough down the middle. He would go out to the wings, he would drag the centre-halves out. And at that time, Bilbao had a tremendous centre-half called Jesus Garay. And he was top-notch, this guy. But Tommy Taylor led him an absolute dance that night. And then, as I say, 10 minutes from time, he drifts out to the right, and a long through ball from Edwards, and he pulled Garay out to the touchline. And as he jockeyed down the line, he suddenly cut inside him, and he saw Johnny Berry coming in, put the ball across, Berry hit it on the volley, into the back of the net, and United were through to the semi-final of the European Cup. That was probably the best atmosphere that I've ever been involved with at a match, you know. And I know Brian played in one of the greatest games ever against Barcelona, and the atmosphere there was unbelievable. Very, very similar, coming back from a big deficit and overturning them. But United at that time, when they went into Europe, they didn't know a lot about these European teams most of the times when they went out there. It was the first time they ever saw their players was when they went out on the pitch. But they were a phenomenal team. The Busby Babes, they played the game in the right way, and they could they could play any system, 4-2-4, 4-3-3, whatever system suited them, they would adapt to it. And for me, they're the finest team that this club has ever produced. And I may be a little bit biased there, but some great, great memories. Yeah, and it's lovely to stand up here and talk to you. I'm not going to go on because there's a lot to go on. All I would like to say is thank you. It's, again, I reiterate, it's wonderful to be here amongst the Red family, amongst all these great people, amongst the former players there, who, you know, this club is unique. There is not another club in this world that can compare to the Manchester United Football Club. And also the greatest fans that are about. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much. Enjoy the evening, and it's great to be here.
Ladies and gentlemen, let's hear it for the one and only, the boy from Charlton-on-Medlock, Mr. Thomas Clare, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you.